We have with us tonight, we're very lucky indeed, to have one of the finest writers that ever appeared on the scene, you know, over the last 3 or 4 years, who, you know, seldom if ever read in her own neighborhood. Sometimes, if you're lucky, you might catch her at St. Mark's Church. And sometimes, if you're even luckier, you might happen to go to something that she's put together over at the musical from time to time. Since I've been knowing Hettie a thousand years, it feels like, is that not only is she an accomplished writer, but also she has certainly encouraged an awful lot of young writers who are now making a name known in the literary scene now in poetry and fiction. And she herself has not only worked as a copy editor and editor, but she's been working diligently not only in universities, but as some of you probably know, with women who find themselves incarcerated in this state and elsewhere. And in doing that kind of work, of course, she published a great anthology, which I suggest, you know, you get a hold of women in prison writings. And recently, I had the pleasure of being invited to a performance of reading that she did, that she organized over at the New School, which she had invited some people who had been incarcerated, as well as they did a play by a young man about people being on death row, which is a very fine play. Right now, I'd like to give you Hettie Jones.
Well, I hope I live up to everybody's expectations. Thank you very much, sir. Wow. Totally, it helps to get old, right? Get a good intro. I'm going to read from my book, Drive, and I'm also going to read from a new manuscript that I'll tell you the name of when I get there. And I have 20 minutes, and I promise not to violate it, so I'll read real fast. Drive is organized, because you have to be organized to do as much as I do. It's organized in 4 sections. Driver, lover, witness, woman. And so I'm going to read maybe 1 or 2 poems from each section, okay? I won't read Hard Drive because everybody knows that one. I'll read The Woman in the Green Car. The woman in the green car does not know where she is going. So she goes doggedly, see her sturdy little foot on the gas pedal, how she presses for time, how she speeds. The woman in the green car is racing past you, Providence, gives you nothing save her passage, what disturbance, what mute air. The woman in the green car is driving too fast. She takes the outside lane to pass a truck with 6 red taillights, but the guardrail is close. It is flashing the headlights of oncoming cars. She is scared, hypnotized. The rail takes her left eye, the truck her right. A wide white truck, and then on the far right, an unlighted sign, Mamaroneck. And she remembers having an argument with him, her boyfriend. He said, when you grow up, you'll go to live in Mamaroneck with Marjorie Morningstar, and she couldn't envision it. When he insisted, she grew afraid. What did he know? But she couldn't make herself. There was nothing in her mind to put her there, and she invented her own life, she said to the interviewer. She said, I remember this guy. He said, Mamaroneck, and I couldn't see it, you know? My mind was empty, like death, says the interviewer. Well, yes, she says, I guess death. She pulls ahead of the 2 wide truck of boys. The light holds the wheel tight. Fear is death. Cheat it twice. Leave it in Mamaroneck. Good old paint. The car shows my hand how to turn, and this way I learn, driving into what I have not been, like a switchback to a higher elevation. What I mean, of course, is life, and then here comes death around some corner. Oh, but what if love is at the next bend with a great send-off? Maybe fate for many arms, or take these geese above this wooded road, and me, I burn rubber. This is for my new car, my present car. Ruby, my dear. The woman in the red car has a hand on the wheel and a hand in the air. She's keeping time to the music of her future. She wants to know it. She wants nothing to do with it. Maybe she'll drive fast enough to pass it, right past the narrow walls of her destiny, knocking them flat with one blow and driving over them clear into paradise. The woman in the red car is thinking of living forever while thinking of not thinking of it. Her hands on the wheel, her hands in the air. This is from this section about love. Words are keys or stanchions or stones. I give you my word, you pocket it and keep the change. Here is a word on the tip of my tongue, love. I hold it close, though it dreams of leaving. Sonnet. Love never held my hand like those summertime couples, palm to palm, the perfectly interlaced fingers, the pressures. Love never flung himself around my shoulder or measured my convivial waist. Love was a grandmaster, though, and he laughed when he came on like gangbusters. Who could refuse him? Ah! I knuckled under, no regrets, but I've always wondered. Enough of the love. Oh, no. Enough of love. Now, maybe I'll read this. Because it's about someone I used to know who lived on the Lower East Side. Thank you, Mr. Steve. It's called Freddie in Memoriam. I used to know a man who fixed the roof or the car or my cunt or whatever else needed attention. But now he's dead. Someone shot him through the heart. And ever since, my heart sinks when I touch the small switch on my bathroom light. For he could hold with his large, graceful, hardened hands a 2-inch screwdriver, 1-inch switch on the toilet seat, laughing. His death was not an issue, the switch was. But now it's on me, I switch roles, I fix the roof, I have to love myself the way I never did before. I think it's, who knows, 10 years. You know how it is, Lucille, sometimes it's necessary to read a poem. The next section of Drive, which is called the Semi-Permanent Gate List, has to do with politics, situations in the world. And this poem is sort of goes along with a whole series of poems that I have called A History of War. And it's called Look at How We Live, Look at How We Die, for Nestor Serper Castellini of Peru. It doesn't happen that death's door opens and then slams shut here. Here we live to die, drinking bitterness and dirty water, as would you with your hat and American shoes if every day the sun broke your skull in the fields and you came home to thirsty children. The man in this grave is only one of the newly dead who were barely alive while the beast that corners us fattens. Here we live to die, don't forget that, and he was only one, only one. I just want to mention that I wrote that poem because of the work that I do at the Bedford Hills Correctional Facility. And I teach a writing workshop there and very often bring in newspaper articles, because when you're incarcerated for years and years and years, you lose touch with the outside world. Even though you may read the paper from time to time, it has less meaning than those because your world is so circumscribed. And so I very often bring up a newspaper clipping and say, here, let's write about this. And I always write along with the people in the workshop. So keeping track of time. I want to read my poem Home, although maybe you've heard it, some of you, but because I wrote it originally for a project that was an art project that was done on the Lower East Side and for many years was part of a book that was in the Lower East Side Federal Credit Union on the corner of Avenue B and 3rd Street or 4th Street.
Third.
It's still there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hope so.
Mm-hmm.
it was a project on homelessness, and I decided I didn't know anything about being homeless, but what I did know about was home. So it's called Home. Deep to the heart as the truth strikes home. Ladybug, ladybug, fly away home, home in. Home is the sailor, home from the sea. The hunter, home from the hills. Welcome home, safe home, home port, home base, harvest home, home of the brave. Be it ever so home, there's no place like home. Chickens come home to roost. Charity begins at home. Home is where the heart is. Home is where you hang your hat. Home, sweet home. Make yourself at home. You'd be so nice to come home to. Something to write home about. A man's home is his castle. Keep the home fires burning till the cows come home. Lassie, come home. Bring home the bacon for hearth and home. Home brew. Don't leave home without it. To market, to buy a fat pig. Home again, jiggity jig. This little tiki stayed home. Ate us out of house and home. Home folks. Homegrown, homebound, homeboy, homegirl, home team, home game, home run, home plate, down home, homestead, home front, home ground, home stretch, all the way home, home at last, home free. I forgot to mention that it's a house. that's why it was a heart. And in the X it says, homeless, tempest tossed, with no direction home, broken home, homesick, can't go home. And I wanted to read this. This is called Manhattan Special, just because it's getting to be cold and wintry and everything. Tracking this afternoon's last daylight, I chase the sun to Washington Square, leaving the ground that leaps to 1/5 Avenue's Deco Blue and Nile Green lintels. Everything, even the wind, stills as that light pursues its goals. Nothing pursuing me except this year's close calls. Dark as I turn into Fifth Street, nightfall, windfall, new year, glowing. That's to give us all a little hope. The last section of this book is about women and their concerns. And I like to follow the progress of women all over the world, and I have a whole series of poems about the women in Afghanistan, but this one has to do with women in Turkey, and I found out about them through the newspaper. It was another one of my assignments for Bedford Hills, and has the little newspaper article as an epigraph. It's called Amin and Kamin. Ankara, Turkey, August 2, 1995. Amin Deniz, 40, and her daughter Hami, 22, were slain in a Black Sea province on Monday by four members of their family for dressing revealingly. I have this feeling you were beautiful, Amin. I have this feeling you were smart. I think you married the guy with the power not because he wanted you most, but because you wanted the contest. You pleased him at first, gave him a jewel of a girl, Tamid, and later sons, as he'd expected. Still, he kept you out of his business, left you to mothering, had a few women. And after the last time you couldn't conceive, he left you alone. Then you became for him a stone face wrapped in black cloth and clothed your daughter in your pride. Amin, Hamid, what did you do to break out? To explode into the universe on principle? Was it principle or an accident or hysteria? Did they find you stripped to swim, laughing and throwing water at each other? It took four members of your family to kill the both of you. Shot you dead. Did they stand you up against a wall, ambush you on your way home? Was your husband, father among them? What were you wearing? Do you want to tell me? It's been such a summer. Was it just so hot in the sun you pushed back your head scarf? What was it you revealed? This is to cover your graves. A blanket of arrogant, naked women, flowers of every size and shape and shade. Mm-hmm. So now I want to read some from my new book, which isn't a book yet. It's just a manuscript yet. Don't you know how that feels? Yeah, it's like, let it go. hard to let it go, but I did have a little time this summer to figure it out. The book so far is tentatively titled Genuflection to the God of Lost Gloves. Long title. This one was so short. I tried to shorten it, but I couldn't figure it out. Yeah. Dear God, I am truly grateful for my small red car, my 30-year-old washing machine, and my kitchen table's extra leaf. As for the rest, like the leather glove lost among the literati, may it serve to remind that only in giving have I ever found a future to transfigure the flesh I can never fathom. Here I have tried to say with my hands full, take that I may be revealed. Oh, God of lost gloves, I'm on my knees, and here is my bare hand. This book is organized according to four sections. Again, it seems like the number four, I don't know why. Mm-hmm. Verse one is called Genuflection to the God of Lost Gloves. You see, I've got to keep the table of contents in front of me because I don't even know it all that well. Mm-hmm. So I'll read another one from that section. The first section is in general autobiographical, and I've never written about my early childhood, so I might read about some of that. But I love writing about getting old. I just figure you better put a good face on it because it's inevitable and it's going to happen whether you like it or not. Yeah. Just get ready. So this is a whole series. There are lots of little series of poems in this book, and this one is called Modern Maturity, which those of you who don't know is the title of the magazine that's published by AARP, the Association of, what is it, Retired Persons?
Sorry.
And it's like hysterical because if you're a writer, who can retire? What, right? But this one, this is in three parts, and the first one is called Attitude. So it's come to this, and it spells Social Security down the side. So it's come to this, I'm old, a senior citizen, not sure if I'm to ask for help or love. But isn't it sweet that I'll be getting money every month? And a subway pass, like a child in school. And I'll walk up to the movies and demand my rights. As a valued elder, I'll insist that all tickets must now be mine, half price but full view. My life ain't over, you know? Second is anatomy. In the mirror, a full body frown. The right breast, always lower, has found its way farther down. At the curve of that breast, a birthmark they all liked to look at. Now it will have to stay covered. What strengthens as the dying body declines? What sustains? Third, action. Sit up as Zen flesh flash. Over the belly gone to see, to reach out with the scarred hands, the broken pinky, the sliced index finger, across the blue and red veined legs, and on to the as yet unblemished feet. Going over to get over, over and over again. Getting over the hump, getting over the hill, getting over the ruin, the hulk, the husk, the loss, the self. You gotta put a good face on it. Let's see, maybe I'll read this one. I had to write a poem for the millennium because everybody was doing it. It's called Two Grand, and we were thinking of names for the year 2000, and Two Grand was bandied about, but it didn't stick somehow. So I liked it. It's called Two Grand, T-O-O-T-W-O. It was Two Grand in Brooklyn with some grandmothers and grandchildren, students at a junior high called School of the Future. And a little baby caught my New Year's fancy. He was the future I'd come to see fly into my arms in Grand Army Plaza. And it was $2,000 later in Lower Manhattan where I brought to today this future I'd seen, before bringing them all to New Jersey's still air, to the $2,000 arms of my kin, my kind, who came to me by blood and desire. Some people wander the world that is. Me, I conjure the one that isn't. The second section is called Shopping in Diversity. And there's a poem by that title, but I won't read it. I will read. Scenes from the life of the water towers. You see that there was an article in the Times the other day all about, there's a fake water tower that an artist has made of resin, and it has lived in Soho for a very long time, but now it's going to be on the roof of the Museum of Modern Art. And I like to see on my roof of the water tower. So this is called Scenes from the Life of the Water Towers. I really meant it to be performed with music, so you can imagine a choir of angels or a choir of water towers. And I also, it's in memoriam for Denise Levertov, whose Scenes from the Life of the Pepper Trees has been one of my favorite poems forever and ever. High over the neighborhood, facing each other in every direction, day and night thirst, the water towers empty and fill. A woman on a roof counts 20 water towers. Their shadows lean toward her. Rain hits the water towers. Water inside, water out. Water inside, water out. On the roof of the high-rise, a walled-in water tower. Oh, and the new unfinished roofless water towers. Sweet, still, raw wood. The woman hanging her washcloths, running away. Should have one of those echo machines. I'll forget that. All these things are new. This is my very favorite. It's called Hare Krishna Okutur. And when you see it, it looks like Hare Krishna Haute Couture, but it's like it's a little visual pun. The Hare Krishnas hang their robes on the fire escape of the first tenement on Fifth Street, where years ago an old man hung out his huge cotton underdrawers, until late every night he began to shout, "Police! Police! 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 Police!" And his neighbors woke pounding and protesting, and the police finally came and took him away. I hope when they come for me, I'll be shouting something else. The third section of that book is called At the Miami Vice Rest Stop, and has poems about love and sex, whatever. Anyway, this is the title poem. At the Miami Vice Rest Stop for Janine Vega. I'm headed for the bathroom in your shirt, the one your brother gave you. Now he's dead. Miami Vice is printed on the shirt and it's got paint and sweat stains and it's thin and perfect for this weather. I think of you with thanks. Despite your protest, I'll return it. Miami Vice, you ask? Your brother raised an eyebrow. Just like him, the rest stops on its way to being something far from what it was. Two guys eating watch me pass. The sun is hot, the shirt so old, and yet it's legend. Yet these guys, their eyes meet mine, my advice. It's got a visual pun in there. I hope you will read it one day and see it. Okay, this is a wonderful dirty poem that I wrote a long time ago, but I never had any place to publish it. It's used for long earphone sex for race and gender. I wrote it before there was such a phrase as phone sex.
Whoa.
A long time ago. Hello, she says. Hello, he says. There is a wandering colored person under your window shouting and no one has heard. Oh, sorry, she says. And this person, just what color is it? Black, he replies fiercely. A black man. Really, she says, you never will fix your glasses. He is much more colorful to me. Can't you see his blues, his greens, the long white arc of his multi-continental semen? Oh, come off it, he says, idiomatically. I'll be happy to, she answers. Cocksucker, he he says familiarly, just throw me the key. Oops, I'm over my time. All right. I'll just read the one that I wanted to read last. How about that? And then Steve is going to ask me questions. I'd like to end with a signature poem, and this is one that I kind of feel it really describes me. If I sing on a rainy Sunday, chances are I'll go on with it, and you know that I can get my throat over. On this bowstring of Sundays in my convoluted gut, I sing a long, long line, I sung a long, long time. I sing a long, 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 long line, I sung a long, 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 long time. I sing a long, 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 long line. I sing a long, 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 long time. Thank you.
We're going to have about three minutes for questions. And by the way, I meant to mention is that the book of poetry that Hettie was reading from earlier is a prize-winning book of poetry. So give her a hand for that. I'll start with one question, and everyone else can ask whatever they want to, of course. The only question that puzzles me about you and your illustrious career is that you're busy doing a million things at one time, working in a prison system, plus teaching, and plus, having to do other things in your life. How do you find time to knock out poetry anyway? To write?
Well, I was describing earlier to Christina. But I, years ago, when I was most ambitious, I used to drink coffee every 2 hours and take speed in the morning. after I got too old to do that, I decided that I would just set certain priorities. And even if I got to my work as the last thing I got to at the end of the day, I would get to it as often as I could, and every day, if I possibly could, even if I was tired. And it helps to always have one thing to work on, because otherwise you feel bereft, and as though there's no reason for you to be doing all the other stuff, because you don't have a center. So I try to make sure that there's one poem, or a story, or something that I'm working on that I can look at least, even if it's just at night before I go to bed. It's just a comfort in some way.
Far away, you guys.
Nobody got me.
Yeah.
Where do you teach? Where do I teach?
And what do you teach?
Oh, I teach writing.
Because I don't know how to teach
it. because I was an editor for such a long time, and a lot of people don't need direction on what to write about, but rather just craft instruction. So I really try to focus on craft and let everybody decide their own subjects. Some of my students are here. I can tell you.
where do you teach?
Oh, I'm migrant labor.
Oh, she's awesome.
Yeah, so I,
a mercenary.
Yeah, well, no, I just go where I'm located. I never have had a regular job, and I think that's because I always wanted to belong to myself. I think that helps too, when there are days when I can work on my poems or on a story. I mean, I might have a whole afternoon or a whole evening. I guess because I also had children, to answer Steve's question, I got used to putting them to bed and then going to work at night. I mean, going to my desk at night or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned at Biff and Hill, they're bringing the newspaper articles. What are the things, what are the ways you do to prompt writing?
I use a lot of the stuff from teachers and writers, which I found can be adapted for people of any age. And over the years, since I've been doing that for 10 years or more, I've just developed ways. I'll go get a book and make an exercise out of sort of studying some person's style. Last week I was there and I took them Kenneth Coates, a series from his new book. And he has a marvelous poem called To Jewishness, My Heart, Paris, Trees, and Destiny. Something or other like that. So I just asked the students to think of five things and gave them the categories. You know, some aspect of yourself that you appreciate a lot. And then I made sure they used the word destiny at the end. And it worked out. They got some terrific poems. But Teachers and Writers has really good stuff. I used the Handbook of Poetic Forms and Alan, whatever his name is, Ziegler's The Writing Workshop. I used that to develop my own exercise. And prose stuff. Sometimes I don't get much help. The book What If by Anne Bernays has been useful. Because that breaks things down in terms of craft. Anne Bernays and somebody else. Yeah.
The only question I often wondered about with you and your work in prison, which I think is very heroic, and I think you know, there's a whole bunch of other writers that do things like that. We have a woman's shelter across the street, and certain writers have certainly worked with those women across the street. On the emotional level, when you first started doing that, or even now, you find it very painful in terms of you know, what those women are going through, in terms of your encountering them from week to week, and what happens with your lives.
Yeah, well, you know, I have women in my class who are, you know, the political prisoners, you know. Kathy Boudin and Judy Clark are in my class. And it's very hard to look at them and realize that any one of us who were around in the 60s could have gone that route, although I'm a little older than they, and I think you and I are both. But they didn't believe in the methods that they wanted change to come fast, and they got seduced by the idea of violence as a way to, and they didn't realize. And they both regret having done that. But people were killed in the action that they took part in, and they're very guilty about the loss of human life as something that didn't even work. But then again, there are other people that I deal with who are in for just like, what would you call common garden murder? People who have, but there's always a reason. There are people who have been so abused as children that abuse is all that they know. And so that they went on to abuse their own children and perhaps kill them. And then you have to look at people and see the whole person, not just, a person is not their one act. A person is their whole self and their whole life. And some of them are dynamite writers once you work with them, once you get them started. Bedford Hills has a college project now, and one semester I taught in the college. I taught my regular college class in their college project, and I got terrific poems. Remember I was doing that? I was telling you that. And, you know, there are people who, by virtue of where they were born or what family they were born into, I'm not excusing their behavior because they will never excuse their own behavior, you know, but guilt, and guilt never goes away, you know. But you have to see them again, a person in his or her circumstances. I also had an opportunity to go to Louisiana last spring to teach in a women's prison there. That was a trip.
Like, before, right?
there were two rooms, each this size, that were used as school rooms for a prison of like 750 women, and most of them worked in the fields, and their opportunities to better themselves through education, so that even if they had been sentenced to life in prison, could improve, that could improve the quality of their lives, were non-existent. They hardly had any education or any educational opportunities at all, and no opportunity for art or music that would make their lives any different. That was even more disturbing to me, because at least the women and Bedford is a special place. I don't, I guess because it's in Westchester and close to New York and under, you know, under people's eyes, but the women in Louisiana were not allowed to touch one another at all for any reason. So even if they'd had trouble in their family or something, it's like they couldn't offer each other the solace of an arm, you know, of a hug. And it's that way upstate New York at Albion, which is the other prison where many of the women in New York State are sent. They're not allowed to touch each other either. Mm-hmm. So when you think, and this is not the case at men's prisons. It's so bizarre when you deal with...
How do they keep them from touching each other?
Do it on the sly. And of course there are lesbian relationships that go on the sly. But to make a rule that you can't even offer comfort to a friend, it's bizarre. And you know, it goes against human nature. And it also means that people do worse in prison than they could possibly. Because you got to realize also that everybody but a small minority of the people who go to prison will come out into society. And that reintegration can only be helped if there is some kind of rehabilitation, but, you know, where, you know, like, there's 2 million people in prison. Mm-hmm. I have my one foot on my soapbox.
Go ahead.
It's 2 million people in prison in the United States right now. Yes.
What comfort would you offer to, say, the parents whose child was killed by one of those women?
That rarely happens. As far as I know, people usually kill their own children during the course of an act of abuse. I've never met a woman who has killed someone else's child. The people who have murdered that I know have killed their husbands, their mothers, or their children. It's wild, right?
Mm-hmm.
So somebody else's kids. Yeah.
You know, in Florida, the men who are on death row, they're not allowed to touch anybody. No one's allowed to touch them. It's like a form of torture.
Yeah.
And some of them are there for like 5-10 years, and then they can't touch anyone that long. It's like Amnesty International does things about that.
Yeah.
Like they're against the death penalty.
Well, I'm going to have to cut it off here, folks. Okay. Candy's here to sign books, so
okay.
If you want a book, go ahead up there and she'll sign it for you. Great job, everyone.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Hettie.